Welcome to the broadcast. We're here with Anthony Finkelstein. He is the Professor of Software Systems Engineering and Head of the Department of Computer Science at UCL. This November, he will receive the Oliver Lodge Medal at Lord's Cricket Ground. The medal recognizes his achievements in the field of requirements engineering. It's a pleasure to have him on the show to talk about this, his career and computer science.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I want to talk about computer science, but first of all, I want to talk about the journey to where you are now. When was the first time that you developed an interest in computer science?
Well, that's an interesting question. Now, I'm not exactly sure I can pinpoint exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, I've always been interested in science and engineering. I've always been interested in facts. I was a sort of child that read fact books. Geeky child, and I was also very much interested in how things were made. That was what interested me. I was interested in if there were ever books on how it works and so on. I used to absorb that. And I used to love these sort of 1950s knowledge books. Like there were one of them is classic called Inquire Within, which you full of these sort of the biggest bulldozer in the world and the largest crane and what have you. So that's what I think got me into technology.
This curiosity for how things were made.
Yeah, absolutely. Curiosity for how things were made.
Because you wanted to understand the things around you, or?
Well, I don't know that I've ever anatomized it in that much detail. Yes, perhaps curiosity about the world around me. My first encounter with computers, not exactly. Of course, just at the time I was coming to the end of my schooling, little electronic devices started being widely available. So, I remember being at school and seeing the first calculator.
So these new machines started to emerge, and you're coming out of secondary school and you're making a decision that maybe this is a career choice for me?
No, not at all. Computing didn't seem like a career. It wasn't an available university option at all. And so that wasn't something that was a possibility. And I went off and studied engineering, and in the process of studying engineering, then computing became a realistic possibility. But the way it's quite strange, I've got a lot of friends of my contemporaries, and virtually all of them, who are technologists or so on, or technically inclined, have been eaten, you might say, by the computer industry. But that's not how it appeared at the time. I don't think any of us envisaged that being the career. That being so, if you at that stage, computing wasn't the all-embracing thing that it appears now and appeared to be a career option.
Sure.
However, by the time I graduated in 81, I'd done an engineering degree, and I also had experience at that stage. I'd done a sandwich degree and worked in industry. And really in my industrial, both at university and my industrial experience, I started getting real hands-on experience of computing. And then I became quite obsessed with that because it appealed to my engineering instincts, but also the fact is that I'm actually incompetent when it comes to what you might call real engineering, in the sense of anything that I have to make or break. I have very poor 3D spatial understanding. So software was much more appealing from that point of view.
Yeah.
So I started playing around with the mainframe at the university, and when I was in industry, I was given a basically sort of hands-on old computer, PDP-8.
Yeah.
So basically I started trying to see what I could do with that, which I really enjoyed.
See, that's very interesting, because when you look at the career of people with computers, obviously computers emerged very quickly, but there was a point, if you take, for example, Bill Gates, and it is said that early on he got access to a mainframe, I believe, which was very rare in his childhood, and it was really luck that he got access to it, and he got a lot of hours on that, which some people believe were a differentiator in determining his career. So would you say the same with you?
The Gladwell,
Malcolm Gladwell hypothesis, the 10,000 hours.
Yeah, so, unfortunately I've not read the book, but I do know about the hypothesis. I mean, there's no question that, I think one of the key things that Gladwell says is that when you graduate, and when you, defines a lot about what your likely career possibilities, it depends what industries are in boom and what industries are not. So I was very lucky. I was one of those people who came out of university at just the right time to ride the crest of the computing wave.
You didn't perhaps, as you said, recognise that there was a wave at all. I mean, it was just something you were interested in and you followed it.
Absolutely not. And in fact, I would like to say that that in some senses I could foresee those things, but I'm not sure.
What are the big developments in computer science that affect on society?
Computing is ubiquitous. Digital technologies are ubiquitous in the
especially in the Western world.
I should say in the developed world. Interestingly enough, their power and reach even in less developed countries is quite large, and it's interesting that many of these countries are entering, many less developed countries are entering the digital, are becoming digital societies, though in a very different, through a very different trajectory. Thus, for example, in many parts of Africa and so on, mobile technologies.
Because there are no landlines.
No landlines, so communication by mobile and so on are there, and so, yeah, but stepping back, for certain, pervasive, computing is pervasive, the advances in the ability to build software, to communicate and so on, have fundamentally changed the way we do business, the way we are entertained, even the way we socially interact.